Bon dia a tothom. Buenos días. Good morning. So my pleasure is to thank all of you your attendance. This is the first integrative seminar series of this year. We have been we got a gap in the last trimester, but we have decided to start with Luca. So thank you, Luca, for accepting the invitation from the department. But first of all, I would like to say a couple of things. There have been small changes in the organization of the Integrative Research Seminar. So after the seminar, we'll have some snacks outside just to try to keep the research discussion ongoing. This is part of one of the changes. Another change is that there will be a small evaluation of the organization itself. After the seminar, we'll send an email to all the people that has been registered to the seminar. Today's speaker is Luca. Luca has been with us for 6 years, I think. He's an ICREA senior researcher at the DETIC, specifically at the Center for Brain and Cognition, that, by the way, they have moved recently to the other campus. I see this movement as a part of an invasion of the DETIC to the Ciutadella campus. So. But today's talk is about ontogenies of rational thinking. Luca has been moving all over the world. He has been in several parts of the States. He got a PhD at Rutgers University some time ago. We won't say the year. But he has been also in France, in Italy, and now in Barcelona doing nice things about rational thinking. So you have 45 minutes, and we'll have some questions, I hope, okay, at the end of your talk.
Thank you very much. So what I'm presenting here is sort of an overview and trying to make a small argument. So part of the work is from my lab, and part of the work is, as you will see, the most interesting one from other labs. This is collaborative work, and this is in yellow the persons who mostly contribute to what I'm presenting today, and there are other collaborators a bit all over the world. The nice part, some of you who teach at the masters might recognize some of the names that are here, because although the integrative part of the seminar doesn't work maybe too well from the top, certainly the bottom is starting getting integrated. So there are several students who took our master at CBC who also were past or would become future students in the masters that the DTIC is offering. That's a good sign. A little word about the title. I have to say I am a philosopher as a training. And I've always liked to do something which is philosophically interesting, but never, I was never able to do anything interesting, really. So, but I always like to do something really deep and food for thought. So this time I got this occasion to come, and thank you very much for giving it to me. And I thought, okay, these are engineers. What do they know? Stuck a title that would satisfy my philosophical ambitions, but that's all what I have to say about ontogenesis of rational thinking. Indeed, nobody knows anything about it, and certainly I don't. So the only reason for the title was to invite people to come here. Okay, let me tell you really what I'm after, and I'm going back to it. I'm really after this kind of thing. The fact that as early as you look at the archaeological records, you find productions in humans which are extremely sophisticated. Paintings like this one, but also computers, for example, or for that matter, and the sink and the siphon in the sink, something that we should be grateful every time we go to the bathroom every day, right? What I mean is there is an incredible amount of material culture that we tend to underestimate in everything, in every single behavior that characterizes human species. And everything that we see here is a set of invention, is a set of solved problems, from clothes to computers to everything. And I'm fascinated by it, and I would like to somewhat give my little contribution to not to explain this phenomenon, we will never be able to explain it, but to somewhat know where to move in this search. Okay, now to explain this, my task is to study young infants before they start being able to teach, so to interact with us. But you as current and future and prospective engineers or computer scientists might ask yourself, why should I be interested in young infants? And so first, before going on to the actual research, I wanted to make a couple of points which can be summarized by this this title. You know, you're very much into deep learning here, but you know, my feeling is that there are other things that maybe deep learning might not necessarily solve completely. And here is one. This is one of the most active areas of research in these years, self-driving cars. Great. I mean, this is something on which deep learning algorithms are applied. However, there are also, and excuse me for the pun, there are also some ethical issues that really deep learning is not going to help you to solve. So if at a certain point you have a little child who is in front of you and the tree, you've got to figure out whether your car has to crash against the tree or kill the little child, right? That's a problem that is not going to be solvable if not by studying deep philosophical issues. What happens if instead of one person, there are very many persons in the car, right? How does this change? These are decisions that have to be taken. No way to find them out of the data. That's one of the points I wanted to make. And this is the second, a little closer to what I want to talk about. And it has to do with the fact that there are psychological issues that one has to keep present when asking oneself, how can I make a machine that thinks, or how can I make a machine that interacts with humans? And to exemplify this, let me just give you an example that comes from the from this. You look at on the web and you find that now we have these perfect companions which are domotics robots, our new best friends, who, by the way, is very good because it uses deep learning protocols to interact with humans. Okay, very well. But, you know, how do you actually interact with humans? And here is an example that comes from the Tomasello laboratory of how a human interprets a situation. And so this is a little child who sees a set of actions. And and what the child does is a spontaneous helping behavior, right? And there is not much data that is needed. He knows what the situation is about, and he knows how to interpret the intentions of the speaker. So my point is that if you really want to solve problems in robotics, you need to figure out how to interact in the right way with these humans, and for example, with infants, and you need to ask questions about what does a human or a child want? What kind of psychology does she have? A little child doesn't have the same psychology as an adult. What kind of conclusion, and this is my my main focus, what kind of conclusion can a little child draw from a given situation so that there is an inference being made, expectations being created? And these are problems that I believe put together people who work in my domain and people who might work in your domain. These are not issues that you solve by simply extracting information from the data. You have to figure out something about the early structures of reasoning and thinking from which our ability to create these things come from. Okay. On to business now. If you want to sort of see the kind of words that you might use in order to explain this incredible productivity that characterizes our species, you find these words: creativity, problem solving, tool invention, use, material culture, causal explanation, and science, among all these kind of things. But all of this starts with the fact that we are born as infants, and therefore we somewhat have some a priori about what we want, what kind of conclusion we can do, what kind of psychology we have. And what is the model of early psychology that has been very successful in the last 40 years? Well, this is the model that infants can do a lot of things, much more than what people thought before, because they have modules, which are essentially pre-compiled ways to solve problems, which have been selected by evolution. And these are some of the areas on which researchers have found that infants have priors very well structured in terms of ability to solve problems. Categorization, number, geometry, theory of mind, object, and so on. There is no denying that these exists. Recently, there is another picture that starts being proposed, which has more to do with rational thinking. And the picture shows, tries to show, that there is much more than just pre-compiled ways to solve simple problems. And I want to mention three areas in the literature that I think are particularly interesting. One is the work that has been done in Budapest by the group of Gyurgy Gel and Gergő Csibra about how we interpret infants interpret actions in a rational way. One is the work done at MIT by Laura Schultz and her group about how infants quickly attribute causality and test hypotheses about failures of situations. And one is the work by the group at Johns Hopkins by Lisa Feigenson and her collaborator about how infants use rationally failures of understanding as occasions to learn. These are all three kinds of evidence, these sets of evidence, that suggest that really infants are early rational thinkers. And I invite you who are more into artificial intelligence to think of how you would, as it were, incorporate into a machine the kind of phenomena that I am presenting now. So let me talk about the very famous work by Gyurgy Gel and Gergő Csibra in the early, late 90s. And the idea was the following. You take an infant, and we're talking about infants from now, we know, from 3 months on, so quite early. And you habituate infants, you show them this ball that jumps this fence several times and then gets close to this ball and then makes like kisses to this ball, okay? So this is the physical action that infants are habituated to. And then you present them with two novel situations that they've never seen. One is the one in which the goal is achieved in the most optimal way. And one is the one in which the actual action that infants have been habituated to is repeated. Okay? You would imagine that if infants, as it were, stay to the surface of the situation, they should find this action surprising because it's new. This, they have seen it many, many times before. Okay? Turns out that that's not the case. Infants are surprised when they see the old action, because now the old action doesn't make sense with respect to the goal that the yellow ball had before. Okay? That suggests that infants don't look at situations as a physical set of happenings, but they look at them by asking themselves, what is the goal of something? Okay? Now, goals can be very sophisticated, and indeed, as I was mentioning you before, the fact that people agree on the fact that infants have a very good understanding of physical interaction between objects, but they are also able to override this understanding if there is a goal. So this is early, I mean, closer to us work by always the group, the Budapest group. And what Southgate and colleagues showed is that when infants see something like that, okay, they're just not surprised at the physical violation, provided that the goal is achieved. They have very clear what the goal should be about. But the goals can be something very, very complicated. So consider this situation again coming from the Budapest group. This is previous work in which Andy Meltzoff showed that when infants see a very funny action, they repeat it, they imitate it, as many other animals do. So if you show that this lights when you hit it with the head, infants will tend to repeat these actions. And this is what the Gergely group showed in this situation. Here is a situation in which this woman shows that she's cold, as she might be in Barcelona in these days, and that's what this woman does. She puts a particular, you know, a blanket on her, and then she performs an action. Okay? The action is very funny, but you see, the action is made in such a way that to the infant, it should appear clear that she wants to do it that way. Okay? And that's what an infant exposed to this will do. He will try to repeat the actions in the following way. However, here is a very similar situation where there is only a little change. Now, experimenter is always cold, she always puts the blanket on her, but uses her hands to keep the blanket. Okay. Therefore now, the action is being repeated equally, but as it were, she does it that way because she couldn't have done it in another way, because she has hands occupied. sophisticated interpretation of an action, right? And what happens in this case is that infants do not repeat the action before, they tend to actually hit light the ball in this way, the light in this way. So that's really, these are the data. The probability of repeating the action physically only occurs very frequently when the experimenter is showing that she could have done it otherwise had she wanted to. Therefore, the relevant repetition there is the physical repetition of the action. But if the experimenter has her hands occupied, okay, then infants don't repeat the physical action, they repeat the goal of the action. That's to tell you that when infants see a situation, they understand not just the physical sequence, but the deep goal of what it is in the mind of the actor. Okay. This is something that comes from the this first point, second point, something comes from the laboratory of MIT. And the idea here is very simple. We are always talking about infants about 14 months old of age. You have a little toy that when you press, it makes music. And the experimenter, and then the infant has two other toys. One is close to her and the other is far from her. And here is what happens. The experimenter takes this toy, and every time he presses the toy makes this nice noise, always succeeding. And then the manipulation here is that in some condition the child gets the same toy or gets the toy that is close to her. Okay? And the trick is when the child activates the toy, it never works. What does the child do? Okay? And that's the question here is, what does she do? Does she get another toy because she thinks that the toy is broken, so it's not she who doesn't know how to activate it, but it's the toy that is broken? Or does she ask help to the experimenter, asking to see it again because she thinks that she didn't understand how the toy works, okay? So the evidence available should give information to the child to get the right solution. And this is what happens in the when the child gets the green toy, okay? The one that was activated by the experimenter successfully. When the child sees that this experimenter was able to succeed, she gives it back to the experimenter. But when this doesn't work, the child goes a long way to get the second one, right? Assuming that because the evidence is consistent with the fact that she knows how to use the toy, but it's the toy that is broken, okay, it's not the proper thing to do to ask the experimenter to repeat the action. Okay, that suggested that infants at this age these are the data, so you can see this is the amount of time that children give the toy back to the experimenter or get the other far toy from them, and it's very clear what happens. Infants use the available evidence to discard the hypothesis about why something is working, why something is not working, and how they should achieve their own goal in this situation. Okay, so another example, in my opinion, of a very rational behavior. And let me just give you the last one. This is really a nice one. Everybody who works with infants work with this method, which is called the violation of expectations, which I'm going to show you data about later, which essentially consists in showing infants things that work in a funny way and look at how long or how surprised they are when they see their expectations being violated, right? Nobody asked the question, all right, but when infants see something that is funny, what do they do with it? And this is what Lisa Feigenson did recently. And the way they did it is they presented infants with physical violations that they know infants are surprised about. Okay, for example, violation of support or as a violation of solidity. Okay, we know that infants are surprised, they look longer at this situation than in a normal situation. But that's not the question that Feigenson asked. The question is, all right, now I give infants the toys that underwent these violations. What do they do? Okay, when they see a violation of support and I give infant the toy, what does he do? Does he bang it or does he drop it? When he sees a violation of solidity, what does he do? Does he bang it or does he drop it? Right? Assuming that if infants are testing a hypothesis about the violations, they should bang the toy that didn't respect solidity more than drop it, And they should drop the toy they didn't respect support more than bang it. And that is exactly what Feigenson showed. This is an index of how much dropping actions or banging actions there are. And you can see that when there is a violation of support, infants essentially bang, drop the object. And when there is a violation of solidity, they bang it. That is, they are really a hypothesis about what the violation says. Okay? Okay, so these were three examples of far away and recent results about infants that seem to suggest that infants understand goal and intentions. These goal and intentions are very subtle, and they can understand them by analyzing a situation at a level which shows an extremely sophisticated psychology. They have expectation about that. They make a hypothesis of what should happen. They understand, that if something is unexpected, that is a learning occasion. They can test cases of failures, and they can explore rationally alternatives. All of these seems to suggest that infants are very good rational thinkers. And therefore, the question that we are trying to work on with our little tools of the what we have available is, all right, if infants are not just sets of modules, if infants have this ability to rationally solve problems, perhaps an ability that explains a little why we have all these fantastic problem-solving activities that make our life of every day, well, how do they start from? What mechanisms make rational thinking possible? Okay? Well, certainly, if you have a hypothesis, you need to conceive thoughts and you need to combine them. Okay, but on the basis of what primitives? What are the very early thoughts that you can have? On the basis of what combination principles? What inferences can you draw? Okay, and the way we do it, we try to figure out whether infants have very, very basic intuitions about what could happen in the future, what might have happened, what didn't happen, why it didn't happen. Okay, and to do that, we test the ability of infants to have expectation about probable events, probable future events, or expectation about some logical consequence of a very simple situation. Let me just show you some of the results that we had. So our game is always to present situations in a non-linguistic way, I'll come back on it, in which there is information that infants should had they had a rational way to analyze the situation. So in this situation, for example, infants see a billiard device in which a ball hits, they hear the noise, I took it away here, and at the very moment in which the ball disappears, I cut the movie, what infants see is a little more extended than that, of course. The ball is at the center, so you cannot see you cannot predict in this moment where it would come out, okay? And the question here is, okay, do they expect that because there are three exits here, it's more likely that the ball comes out from this side than from the other side, okay? This really would require Monte Carlo simulations if you really needed to get to this situation. And our game is presenting for as little as possible so that we at least thought. And now, the story is, yeah, they are surprised when this ball comes out from this side, okay? However, they could be surprised for many reasons. So we compare this situation with a situation in which the device is very similar, perceptually, but now exiting from one particular side becomes impossible. So if they respond by using very surface, analysis of the situation, they should be maybe surprised if the ball comes out here, but they should be surprised equally here. No. But if they analyze the situation as probable, improbable, possible, impossible by using these modal terms, then they should reverse their behavior when they see an exit from this side or from the other side. Is the logic clear? And that's what happens if infants see an exit for one hole here, they are more surprised. But if they see the exit for the three patches here, they are more surprised in this situation, okay? Showing that they are really analyzing the probability and the possibilities involved in this situation. We also can show that in certain conditions, they even anticipate the exit. So in the very same situation, there is an occlusion in our situation, and then the ball is behind. And the question here is, before they see where the ball comes out, do they expect that it will come out when there are the three holes? So we test the anticipation to the exit in the 1-2 seconds in which they don't see the ball. And what you're seeing here is, well, for simplicity, suppose the ball always comes out from this side, and we flip this frame, so that sometimes it has three exits on one side, sometimes it has one exit on one side, okay? And what we found here is that before the exit occurs, their eyes tend to move more towards the three sides than towards the one side, okay? Showing that probable to occur. Now, let me mention this. In the sense of probability that we propose here, they don't get this information out of experience. It's not just frequency checking. It's really feelings that things should occur in this way if you analyze the situation in a particular way that I try to make clear in a second. Okay, now, interestingly, that's the data, it's not important. Interestingly, they don't always anticipate, and that is very funny, right? Remember, I gave you this situation, these two situations, the situation, something could happen here. Probably doesn't. There is a situation in which there is a physical impossibility, this situation here, and there is a physical possibility, probable or improbable. And what we found is that infants are always surprised at the improbable or at the impossible. This is after the fact. But before the fact, so when there is this expectation, potential expectations, they tend to look more at the probable, okay? But they don't care to look more at the only possible way out. In other words, they anticipate a probable situation. They don't anticipate the only possible situation. That is somewhat funny. So at the beginning, we thought, okay, they do that because our movies are really too subtle for them to pick up what is probable, what is improbable, what is possible, what is impossible. Let me make things clearer, and let me make sure that the infants understand that the ball cannot really come out from here. We put every possible information that it should not come out. Will they anticipate that the ball will come out from the only possible hole now? And the answer is, no, they do not. More specifically, after the fact, so when we test their violation of surprise, they're always surprised at improbable exit or impossible exit, okay? But before, so when they have to expect something, they're only surprised when there is a probability stake, not when there is something essentially deterministic. Now, if you think about it, that's also very rational, because what infants are doing here they move their eyes only if there is a possibility of reducing the uncertainty of a situation. Why should I anticipate something that I know is going to happen that way? When there is a probability distribution, that's the moment in which I have knowledge to gain. This can be made formally precise. And that's what we find, that infants anticipate only when there is probability at stake, okay? Unless, there is nothing else. Of course, if you beat them up, they will probably anticipate also the possibility, but that's not what happens. Okay, this situation, this kind of behavior does not occur because of any particular feature of our stimuli. Here are completely different situations which maintain physically different situation, which maintain though the same kind of logic. Here is not the device that carries the probability, but the number of objects. And you can see here that here it would be an improbable exit, here would be a probable exit. And what we found is that even in this case, if infants are surprised when they see an improbable situation, and again, this is not carried by the fact that these stimuli are different physically. For example, they could look longer here because there is some sort of gestalt, principle here, so they look longer because there are three things here which are sticking together, okay? Not the case, because if you transform these situations in possible versus impossible situation, by just simply putting a bar that forbids the yellow object to come out, we find again a complete reversal of infants' looking behavior. So they look longer at an improbable situation, but they look longer at the impossible situation, even if physically the situations are very comparable. Okay? Very well. We can do something more. We can actually ask questions about, okay, on the basis of what mental representation do they do? these kind of conclusions. And do they represent possible outcomes, possible future states, or do they simply represent the ratio between quantities? And to do that, we did situations in which we presented the same distribution. I'm only presenting the final part of the movies. I hope that the situation is clear. Here there should be an object coming out, and it doesn't. So in one case, we have a 3 versus 1. In the other case, we have a 12 versus 4. And what we found is that infants can anticipate the next future event in this situation, but they have no expectation in this situation, suggesting that they don't represent ratio, but they represent really the amount of possibilities, so insofar as they can imagine them, few possibilities, of what might happen in the next future moment of their presentation. We can also show that this is really not depending on device and difficulty at understanding these devices. Because if we put another kind of information, for example, density, making these objects bigger, these are the same objects but bigger. So it's really hard here physically for this object to come out, say, in 1 second. But it's easy for this object to come out in 1 second. Then they do the right kind of reasoning. Okay? Okay. All of this suggests that they have a pretty sophisticated sense of probability. Doesn't depend on the surface feature of the situation, but it does depend on how many probabilities they can envision. Okay? So what we are trying to do in our current work is to ask the question, all right, if they really have this sense of probability, where does it come from? And the idea that we are trying to push is that it really comes from their sense of possibility, from their modal interpretation of the situations. This is an old idea that you can still that you can find already in Wittgenstein, and this idea that that facts in logical space. So what we see is not what we see. Mamma mia! Sorry, I don't know why. Oh, what we see is not what we see. But what we see is what we could possibly see had we present the possible distribution of possibilities for the future events. So if you assume this idea, if you have a logic, so if you have a sense of modality, probability comes from free, essentially. Just count the possibilities. And that's what we are trying to figure out now, whether we can show that infants have a sense of logic that would allow them to reason about the probabilities of the next future events, if they can count them. There is preliminary work that we did. Well, but does it make sense to ask questions about, okay, do you have a logic in your brain? Maybe you don't. You know? So the first thing we did, we worked with adults. And we asked, okay, if I show adults very simple reasoning, like this one, for example, suppose I give you a premise that means nothing, all roughs are blickets, okay? Then you see a second premise, which is John is a knock. What can you do? Nothing. These are unconnected. That's the only thing you can do. But if the sentence would have been all knocks are blickets, then you can integrate these two, and you can make a logical consequence. So what we do here is we compare when adults see this sentence, whether the previous sentence was integrable via logical inference or not. And we are asking the following question. If you give me the activity of your brain, can I predict what you are doing? Okay, whether you will integrate this information logically or not. And what we found is that, that's not important what happens later, is that in this very moment, well, there is a lot of activity in the brain in these situations. Some of this activity can depend on the logical forms. For example, I can tell you all A's are B's, all C's are B's, and you can conclude all A's are C's, and that could be wrong, right? But every time you see this reasoning, you do the same mistake, okay? So you act on the logical form, but you don't. In other situations, all A's are B's or B's are C's, you could act on the logical form and get the right solution. And what we showed is that there are people for whom we can predict that they are reasoning on the simple form of the statement, and there are people for whom we can predict that they reason by applying a very elementary logical rule. And the area of the brain that are more active in these two situations are different. One is essentially one left ventrolateral prefrontal more frontal activity connected to reasoning logically, and more, as it were, linguistic-like activity connected to simple detection of the form. So in the adult brain, it can be shown that when you reason by very elementary logical reasoning, there is a particular pattern of activity that is predictive of what you are going to do. So our aim now is to really take extremely elementary things, something that I'm ashamed to present to people that do artificial intelligence, like instantiation or elimination of alternatives, A or B, not A, therefore B, or modus ponens, and transform these possible inferences in non-linguistic situation and see whether infants make conclusions on the basis of it. And today I'm going to present, and the interesting thing about that is all these situations have the same structure logically. You need to have logical forms, and you need to have elementary inferences that for which you derive information from a logical form. And what I'm going to present you today is the way we are trying to attack this problem. Do infants do a particular inference? Do they represent a logical form of a disjunction, and they get to a conclusion when we present to them scenes that might contain this logical information? And the way to do it is the following. We create situations in which there are always two objects that are different, different category and everything, but at a certain point, you cannot distinguish which object is here. You can only distinguish when you see the second object, okay? So the flower, you know that the flower is here when you see the dinosaur coming out, and you know that the little baby is here, or the other, the umbrella is here when you see the little baby out. Sometimes the end of this movie is compatible with you having drawn a logical inference, sometimes it's incompatible, okay? So there are two aspects here, I'm going to go back to it, but when we look at the end, so is essentially when we look at surprise, we find that both at 12 months and at 19 months, infants are surprised when they see a situation that is incompatible with a very elementary logical inference, okay? That is not dependent, again, on the way you present the inference. Here is another way in which you present the same kind of situation, but when you have the epistemic evidence that about this object, physically the scene is completed in a completely different way, and this would be a way in which this is the end of the scene, this part here. Okay, you should say this is the ball, but then maybe you see the ball here, that would be the incompatible one. Physically, this situation is completely different from the previous one. Okay, nevertheless, both at 12 months and at 19 months, we find that infants are surprised when they see a situation that is incompatible with a logical inference. Okay, what is our concern? Oh yeah, they also use the situation to predict. So,
hola, vamos a jugar.
This is recorded directly, so the stimuli are better when you present them. But as you see here, there is no violation of nothing.
Hola, ¿dónde me escondo?
We're only asking.
¿Puedes encontrarme?
Whether the fact that they can draw the position of the object.
Hola, Peque.
And then at the end, we show what was the response. Okay. And what we find here also that when infants see these situations, because they're very interested in faces, they use the inference to figure out where the face is, even if there is no violation. So suggesting that it's not like that they're surprised at something that is not respecting a logical inference, but they use physically inferences to make expectations about where objects should be. Okay, now these scenes are simple, but they have this characteristic, namely that they can be decomposed in very particular moments. So here is a moment in which we could call this the event representations. You present simply objects and the particular situation, infants can represent them. And that's it. That's what they can put into memory, right? But then there is a second moment in which, say, if there is anything like a logical form of thought, they could make a disjunctive hypothesis. I don't know which object it is. It's either A or B, okay? Then there's a third moment in which sorry that this moves, it doesn't move in our stimuli. When they could make deduction, remember what I was saying to you before, every elementary logic has this fact, you need to distinguish logical form from inference. And that's what you could do here, right? And then there is a moment in which you can verify if the hypothesis is respected or not. Okay? So what we are trying to do in our laboratory is to go through these steps to figure out if there are behavioral markers that can tell us, okay, the inference is here, the inference is here, that's what he's doing here, that's what he's doing there. That's the aim. And to do that, we can modify situations in which, in certain conditions, we take away the disjuncting hypothesis. How do we do it? Okay, if I represent the same scene, but now you see what is happening, okay, you need no hypothesis, you have the representation of the object, you can check whether what you see here is respected or not, but you need no inference. So we compare situations in which at the very inference should draw an inference with situations in which at the very need not draw an inference, look for behavioral markers. What I'm going to present now are data that, for example, during deduction making, what do they actually do? So, for example, if they're really doing a thinking process in this particular moment that this object comes out, therefore they know, they could know what the object is here, maybe they, you know, they switch back and forth with respect to these two objects. Maybe they tend to look more to this object here, right, which is not interesting. I mean, the most interesting object is by far this one, but this is the strategic one to figure out, you know, whether you're making an inference, what is inside that object. And so what we do, we use eye tracking to compare these two situations in a situation in which you require an inference, in a situation in which you don't require any inference, but because you know what object is inside the cup, in this exactly equal physical situation, in this particular 1.2, 1.5 moment of the setting up of our scenes. What I'm going to show to you now are eye tracking data with adults. We show that during the inference phase, adults tend to look more at this object than at this object, suggesting that, oh, these are adults that have no task. So they don't, so look at this point here. Of course, they look more at the only object that they can see, but when there is the possibility to draw an inference, they tend to look also more at the cup, the less interesting object. This is the plot of the differences, which suggests that they're doing something with respect to what is in the cup. And more precisely, what we do here is we track the average position of the eye during this little moment, okay? According to, so this would be the moment in which you can draw the inference, or in the other situation, this would be the moment in which you can draw the inference. What do you do with your eyes during this moment? And what we do here is we look at two parameters. One is, so here I'm putting in the y-axis the x position, mean x position of the eyes in this very moment. And what you can show here is that during this moment of inference, adults tend to look more at the cup when there is an inference, when there is a possible inference to be drawn, than when there is no inference to be drawn. At the very same moment, at the very same similar situation, this is a 1.5 second, it's very, very short, their pupil dilates more when they can make an inference than when there is no inference to be made, suggesting that there is work being done there, even if adults have no logical task to perform. They are really doing something that we suggest is a very elementary logical inference. Okay, we are working on that with infants currently. In the very same moment, we look at what infants do. These are 90-month-old infants, and we find, surprisingly, essentially, that both in and in the size of their pupil, a 90-month-old response is exactly that of an adult. That the mechanisms that underline the resolution of a very small problem like this one seem to be unchanged from early infancy to adulthood. Okay, this I don't want to show. And yes, and therefore we go back and see what we want to do. This was the model that we have in what is happening in adults. There is a very clear marker of when you have presented a logical form of a problem, linguistically, and a very clear marker of when you are making an inference. But what is the network organization of a brain when you present the very same things, but without language? We know pretty well what adults do when we ask them to reason linguistically. There is a long literature on that. But we don't reason only when we hear somebody speaking. We reason when we go around. We reason when we dream. We reason in any situation, right? And these situations are not linguistic. Are the brain and behavioral processes underlying our ability to reason logically the same, regardless of whether there is language or not? So what we are trying to investigate now is whether the very same structural organization of the brain, the response of the brain to very elementary logical problems, occurs if we present the very same situations, mutatis mutandis, without giving adults any explicit logical task or any explicit linguistic information. Here's what I did. I tried to convince you that very elementary logical reasoning have this aspect of having a logical form, which could be a logical form of language or a situation, and an inferential part. I tried to show you that in infants and in adults, you can find behavioral markers of all these processes. I tried to argue, if you have this, you can also have a foundation of the intuitive sense of probability that we think we have shown that infants have. This occurs in different ways, but essentially in the same way at the prelinguistic stage. And I would suggest that this is might give some little insights into the origin of our rational thoughts. And to go back to our story, what I suggest is that you cannot forget these questions, even if you work from the point of view of the abstract analysis of what a machine could do. You really need to understand, if you want to understand the interaction, is what is the kid doing right now? How is he doing the inference that I think he should be doing now? Under what kind of evidence and what is the information that will lead the child to learn about a violation, not a violation, and so on? How much of it is logic? How much of it comes from his intuition of what is going to happen in the future? And so maybe there is something for which to run more than a simple integrative seminar when we think about our different ways to look at the very same problem, which is essentially the origin of human rationality. Thank you very much. Minutes and 22 seconds.
Great. We have a mic, I guess. Is there any question or comment?
Okay, thanks, Luca. Very nice talk, very nice children. So a couple of questions.
I agree.
So first, about the status. So anybody in psychology, okay, doesn't buy this idea that the baby is a rational little scientist on the crib, I mean, or something like that?
I would say 98.7% of the literature. In fact, the original work that I presented, where all this started, was this goal directness of Gergely in the early 2000, essentially. You couldn't, and this even now, you cannot publish a paper if you put the word reasoning in infants. Because how could they possibly reason? They don't even, they cannot even speak. And there is, more precisely, a literature that suggests that our reasoning abilities are heavily dependent on language with some reasons. So the answer is, well, maybe it may be surprising to you, right? Like it may be surprising to me that there are people who think that we are very behind in understanding artificial intelligence, right? Yes, that's not the normal, as it were, the standard view. Yeah.
Okay.
Essentially, all the evidence that I gave you is all the groups that work on this hypothesis, three or four in the world. Yeah.
Okay. So second part. So in terms of engineers and psychologists, so your view actually is very close to engineers or computer scientists. You're saying, okay, forget about psychology. Let's see observation. Let's use the tools of probability and logic, okay, to understand, how. And these are not tools that are foreign to engineers at all, actually. So you talk about mechanisms, but it's something probably we talk about already. but you are missing one ingredient. So you have probability, you have logic that is about what it's computed, but not how it is computed. Okay, because actually these are sort of intractable framework from a computational point of view, and then you need to do heuristics or whatever, okay, in order to use these frameworks. So
I have no objection to what you are saying. What I am saying, though, is that you're not going to make progress if you want to understand the. If you want to make a computer that interacts with a human, if you really don't have a clear idea of under what condition can an infant draw this inference. For example, if there are three objects, can he draw it? If there are seven, can he draw it? And there are theories about that, and there is evidence about that, suggesting under what temporal frames can he draw it? Should I actually, as a computer, as a robot, help the infant now, or is it the moment in which the infant is learning something, therefore I am interfering with his learning experience? All these kind of questions require you to have a very clear idea of the detailed process of these very elementary kinds of reasoning. So I don't dispute what you're saying, absolutely. What I'm suggesting, though, is that progress can be made if you really take into consideration, in our case, the what, which is still something that needs to be, and if the how, once you try to, so if you set up heuristics, for example, is informed by the actual state of an infant mind. That's what I'm suggesting.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Luca.
Okay. Yes, are you aware of here?
Oh, hello.
So, are you aware of studies in the same vein regarding infants and ethics?
This is a, so there are three traditional concepts of philosophy: the true, the good, and the beautiful. Right? These are really the three pillars of philosophy. We are making some progress on the true. We are starting on the good, and we don't know anything about the beautiful. Let's put it away. So yes, there is some little evidence that that infants, children, let's put it away, have an ethical view. For example, they are spontaneous helpers, as the Tomasello group tried to show. Yeah? They are willing to share a good, even if this gives them disadvantage, insofar as they have a sense of fairness that is respected in the group. This literature exists. Does it go down in our area, namely pre-linguistic, and when infants cannot even act? I don't know, there are many people here who work on this stuff. I would say that we still don't know what happens in the pre-linguistic stage. But they start. There is some work which is start being done on that.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you very much for the talk. There is extensive work by Kahneman and Tversky who argue that we humans are not very rational thinkers. How do you reconcile that? Do you attribute that to the fact that they mainly used language to formulate their questions? Or?
Yeah, I would say take away the Nobel Prize to Kahneman, give it to me. That's essentially the short answer. No, really, there is no denying about all of this, but from the massive evidence that, for example, when you present problems which are slightly more complicated than the ones I presented, adults fail miserably in giving the correct responses. Now, there is a long, long literature why they do it. I think that Tversky and Kahneman were extremely good at finding situations in which they would tend to do it in the wrong way, but it's not very clear, you know, what happens in any of the single situation that Tversky and Kahneman presented. From my point of view, and there is work that we try to start doing, we don't deny the existence of errors of reasoning. What we are saying is that these become developmental problems. So there is a moment in which you start making mistakes as an adult, on the basis of the fact that you could potentially have the resources, the logical resources, not to make the very same mistakes. What we try to do is to find out certain conditions under which the repeated experience, for example, could short circuit the response Suppose that they give you very frequently a piece of information that is countering your prior. So this situation, there is this object that, with three doors here and one door here. Your intuitive expectation is that the ball has to come out from the three doors. It's information that that goes on the opposite direction. Under what? How much experience do you need to give up and say, well, I don't know what happens, but you know, I would expect that it will come out from the improbable side, right? And I think it is possible to generate situations in which the biases that Tversky and Kahneman have give you. They are mistakes. They are reasonable mistakes if we want to short-circuit frontal processes and analyze the situation. I don't think they would be saying something different to what I'm saying up to now. The extra point in which Kahneman and Tversky would say something different is, oh, but this is all has to do with frontal processes. They have to do with a thoughtful, you know, cold reasoning. We, in the hot reasoning, we really go by biases. Thank you. I think that's where we might disagree. I think that there is evidence that this kind of early elementary logical reasoning is as hot as the mistakes of Tversky and Kahneman. So the short answer is, I take these points very much, and they're very crucial. I think there is an answer, and it is they become developmental issues, not, in, as it were, initial state issues. The question is to find out how mistakes arise, not why they are there. Is it sufficient for you?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Should I?
Okay. Thank you. I'm absolutely not in that field, but I recently read an article that was talking about empathy in children. So that children, they have early infants, have an innate sense of empathy, and you say they're natural helpers, but then around 2 years old, 3 years old, then they start to have an acquired empathy based on experience, which is extremely intricate to interpret and might indeed sometimes conflict with the notion of empathy. So the question is, if you can understand so how a basic rational thinking is working, then can you further use it as clue premises to interpret intricate situations and exploit that knowledge, for example, in conflict management or something like this?
Okay, this is a really, really tough question, and it goes way beyond what we could address, I think, experimentally now. Now, consider what I'm studying here. I'm studying A or B, not A, therefore B, right? So from there to figure out, you know, how intricate situations can be used to, as it were, to maintain the natural empathy as opposed to entering a conflict situation, there is a lot of work to be done. My feeling is that if you understand how problems can be made simple by using the intuitive, logical, and probabilistic routines that we know that infants can handle, then you have a handle also to this problem. But that's as much as I can tell you, right? Because there, you know, we are talking about extremely complex situations, and it's not very clear that what I'm saying can be done. Yeah.
Very nice talk. So going back to the question of Philip, is there any systematic bias or mistakes that infants make while reasoning? Is there like a gold standard for that, or is they're perfectly rational in everything that has been tested so far?
The answer is they are perfectly rational in everything that has been tested so far, because that's what has been tested so far, right? That's, I mean, I gave you, this is a very, as it were, unique occasion, and you should be grateful to me. I gave you the full literature, which is available now in this topic, right? So nobody has really worked on biases in infants. And so I'm very sure that there will be many that you can find, and there are certainly some which must exist because there are perceptual mechanisms that will lead you to see things that are not there, and so on. But if you want, I'm coming from the other point of view. I'm coming from the point of view in which I'm trying to show the little part of rationality that exists on the basis of the mountain of irrationality that has been claimed to exist, at least in adults. In infants, it has been assumed that if adults really make these mistakes, obviously infants will. So nobody really had looked deeply, and it's not so easy to, for example, take a problem a la Tversky and Kahneman and transform it into a problem that you can represent non-linguistically. That's really, really hard. So the answer to it is, these are all things that should be done.
And what about the variability across children? Because you are providing like methodologically, you have like an average behavior across the population. So can you tell more about the individuals?
Yes, this would be our hope. The answer is no, because we are so behind that we are really not at the point, at least in this area, to do individual differences studies. Right now, because we are trying to find out, for example, and there are many, many other, let me give you one which strikes me as something that we never thought in those who work in infants, and it is important. We are working with eye behavior of infants. Nobody looked at it, but there was a student who is finishing now his dissertation in England, and whom I followed at a distance, and at the beginning he had this very he had this idea to find the psychological profiles of infants and see how they affect how infants got information. We know that there is something that is close to truth there, because when the infants come to the laboratory, half of them want to escape. They just, and half of them stay there. I mean, maybe the one that we are looking at and the one that we introduce in our data are the ones that are really the most stupid one. I mean, if you're really smart, you don't want to do our experiments, okay? So what he did is he looked at the scanning pattern of infants by coupling it with the profiles that can be gathered of their shyness. And he found that shy infants have a completely different scanning profile in looking at the same scenes, right? Suggesting that there are lots of dimensions on which you can actually ask individual differences questions. And we would very much like to go. So we have the possibility, for example, in our data, to look at this, the correlation that exists between, for example, I have this 1.5 seconds in which I give you the evidence that it would be allowed, would be sufficient for you to draw an inference about this object. But there are infants who don't do it, right? Now, if we were able to sort of profile a little better certain kind of covariates that we could that could allow us to determine the population, then I think we could do it. We are not at the point. In the laboratory, we started doing that with severely impaired infants who have, this is a work that is done by Nuria Sebastian and the Hospital Clinic together. We take our data, our kind of experiments, and we try to characterize whether some of them are predictive at least of some of the deficits that some of the infants might have if they have certain kind of neurological disorders. That's as far as we go, but of course the really interesting question for us would be studying individual differences in the normal child, I mean the normally developing child. I don't think we are there, and I would love if we were able to get there. Is it a good question, Roberto?
Yeah, it's a very good question.
It's the last one, you cannot.
So, you have shown that in adults, for example, at least some of the reasoning processing are language-based or language-mediated. I'm referring to your study with Carlo.
Yes. Well, yeah. That's not exactly what we try to show, but we try to show, and this is,
at least mediated by language area.
This is all. Work that uses language because there is no other way until now. There's only one paper which has ever been published that I know of which studies non-linguistic reasoning in adults, I mean in imaging, okay? Because it's very difficult and it's in principle impossible, really. Because if I give you a scene, what is the reason that you think that the mental representation that you are making is that representation? And the advantage of language, on which there are also issues, is this one, that I block for this factor, right? So these are all studies that have to do with verbally presented material, right? And what we see is that in the verbally presented material, this is by using predictive coding techniques, right? higher activation of BA45 predicts the behavioral mm-hmm. responses of the adults who make mistakes, but they make them consistently.
Okay, so the language, whereas the language area...
Well, this is not really a language area.
Yeah.
So the point is, you get to here, and that is what we would think represents the logical form. And there is evidence, by the way, presented by Palier, Standean, mm-hmm. and collaborator. I'm talking about Palier because he's teaching a class at our master's now. We suggest that this area is... The activation of this area varies according to the syntactic complexity of the sentences that enter this area, right? But then, this area is not necessarily a linguistic area. So what it says is that really logic is not necessarily a linguistic process. The fact that it's mediated via language is because we use language. But the really interesting question for me would be, suppose that I give you my scenes, the scenes that have no information about, and you see them, and do you represent the scenes by using, like Wittgenstein would say, a particular logical form? And does this logical form, for example, what happens in the brain of a 19-month-old infant when he sees this scene in BA45? Right? Maybe this is not a language area, but is a, as it were, language of thought area. In
okay,
which
yeah. My question was about it. What about babies in preverbal?
But, well, that's, you know, help us. What can I say? I mean, that's really what we would like to do, to just to figure out what is the network that is involved in seeing these scenes that contain potentially some logical inference in prelinguistic infants. And my obviously, you're going to have a lot of activation here. But the point here is, do you also activate BA45? Can you show that what infants put into their memory is some abstract representation that has some sort of logical structure, which then maps onto BA45, because that's the syntax area, not of natural language syntax, but of thought. And yeah, these are the questions that we are trying to find a way to work on.
Okay, I have a final question for you, Luca, which is, I guess that there are no cultural or social differences among the infants, right?
Well, there certainly are, and we are unable to pick on them, because essentially, and this is a problem for a lot of our research, we cannot select who comes to our laboratory. And I mean, these are people who come because they basically are either very nice or have a lot of time or are friends, mm-hmm. right? That's it. So it would be really important to figure out, for example, whether the ability to solve the problem in our sense is mediated by the situation at home. Mm-hmm. But we don't have the power to do this kind
okay,
of studies.
And the very last one, why do you decide to make research about infants?
Why do I decide to measure with infants? Because I am essentially masochistic. That's the short answer. But the long answer is because I think that if you really ask yourself, why did, what pushed these guys who had a lot of trouble, like, for example, surviving in the cold, to paint? It's because there is some internal pressure to create. And this creation is not random. This creation is very organized. It's very organized in the painting, and it's very organized in the problem solving. And what I'm fascinated by is, what is the pressure that leads you to actually create? And in the very elementary sense of creating, like finding a solution to a problem in this little sense. That's why, and clearly this thing is universal. What are the bases of this? And one way to answer is, it's a methodological way, is to just go as early as possible and figure out what kind of mental processes infants can do before you can tell them anything. That's a good basis, not necessarily the conclusive basis, but a good basis to suppose that we are talking about something which is the same kind of pressure that led people in the Lascaux cave to just paint what they were painting.
Okay, thank you. Before closing the session, I have an announcement, which is the next seminar will be the 23rd of February, and will be in the person in charge will be Horacio Sajón from the Town Group. Okay, thank you very much, Luca, for your speech.